Welcome to the video. What makes us happy? What makes us happy is universal happiness of everything. That's it. We were created in this universal happiness. We cannot be happy as like a thing being happy. I'm happy, but there's troubles elsewhere. It's impossible. Only universal happiness makes us happy. Fortunately, universal happiness is the condition of all. It is the one condition. Universal happiness, eternal life, is the one condition, without a second. This is the realization that is the only realization there is, actually. We just simply accept this fact. Now, as bad as the situation in the world is, actually, we are in a pretty good situation as far as having the right spiritual technology to deal with the situation right now. Very interesting. We have a very wonderfully condensed understanding of the situation. And universal happiness, the vision of oneness, transcends the entire history of all efforts on this planet. Total freshness. We have the spiritual technology now. We have it. Really, thanks to Jesus. Really, thanks to Jesus, who gave us A Course in Miracles, which if really, really absorb the understanding dawns, this very wide, vast, comprehension dawns. Very simple. We started out on the detour into fear by wanting to be greater than God. And through projection, through the fear that this brought about, feeling like we had to deny reality, saying we've got something better, and this made us feel like we were being dispossessed of reality. We then projected that onto God and said God is trying to dispossess us of reality, and that caused us to be very afraid of God and go into all sorts of more projections, etc. And we ended up in a situation where we don't see God, we don't see everywhereness, we see thingness, and we've been trying to make this thingness impress God that we are mightier than God. This is something greater than God. We've been working on this to such an elaborate extent that we've arrived to come across an actual problem, which is what I say, the continuity problem. And from this continuity problem, the fact that there is this great dread of an abrupt transition into a completely different experience than what we're used to. No similarity whatsoever. We're so terrified of that, we defend against it like crazy. So, we're desperate to resolve this continuity problem. What we do is we default to what we feel is safe, which is our projections. And what are our projections, the totality of our projections is what we call the ego. And we actually projected vice It's our own advice to ourselves, but we project it as if it's coming from some authority, not our own, greater, some greater authority than us. And that's the ego. And so the ego, we turn to the ego and say, ego, how do we solve this continuity problem? The ego gives us the advice that we're supposed to improve this world, improve the world of thingness and impermanence to such an extent to make it this utopian paradise here for the body, for the flesh, that we don't even want to go home. We don't even want to remember reality. We say, we're never going home. Therefore, no continuity issue, right? That's the ego's advice. Forget God totally, forever. Forget reality totally, forever. Forget everywhereness totally, forever. Forget eternal life forever. That's his advice. Now, this advice fails us. Fails to solve the continuity problem because we still want to go home. So we have this constant feeling of failure. Now we turn to the ego and say, ego, I got this feeling of failure. I'm not happy. What do? The ego says, project this failure onto others and see it out there. It's not your failure. It's their failure. They're the ones that are causing you to fail. And then attack those out there that are causing you to fail. Get rid of them and you will not have any failure. That's the solution. So you have this chain of troubles. I call it the four pillars of failure. But at least we can see it. We can see very clearly what we've been engaged with. And therefore, it makes it much easier to disengage with it. Much, much easier. And ultimately, we can back away from the edge of this so-called abyss to the point where we simply say, the only problem I have is a continuity problem. Vision and oneness solves that. That's all I have to focus on. That's the only value there is for me. There is no other value. There's no value in the problems of the world, problems of projection, attack, defense, safety, happiness within thingness. None of those are problems for me. Only the continuity problem is a problem for me. So I only focus there. We can get back to that point. This saves so much time. This saves so much time. The streamlining of the whole situation, which really Jesus spearheaded this situation. There's no question about it. We got to give Jesus the credit for this. And looking at the other teachers, etc. Mostly, largely, they taught very advanced. Those who were really ready for enlightenment, and they spoke in a very high language, language of clarity, very high language, and they were helpful. But what Jesus did was give us this tremendous overview that put this tremendous context, so that we would really be able to save so much time, really. So we're actually, some are in actually pretty good condition in terms of working with this material. They're saving a lot of time. and they're saving a lot of time for everyone. A lot of delay, a lot of delay. And that eventually there will be this like huge healing asylum, as it were, where those who are still engaged in projection and attack, etc., will be seen as, you know, patients needing therapy for sure. And they will be given this loving support to come out of that, instead of just this continual engagement in acting it out. So they may think that they're being defeated or surrounded or something. Eventually they may look at it that way, but that's really not the case. It's like eventually the asylum will be taken back from the inmates, as it were, and they'll get the help they need. Clearly understanding projection, guilt, projection, forgiveness, continuity issue, vision of oneness, putting this all together in a streamlined package, seeing it, that really, really smooths the situation out. It's like all the spiritual teaching of the whole world, it just, once you get this clear model of the situation, your mind is uncluttered. You don't need anything else. You don't need anything else. I was watching a video of this ashram of Sri Sri Anandamaya Maha in Dehradun, and there was an interview there, and behind the people there were these bookshelves with all these books, you know, and I just said, what do they need these books for? What do you need books for? And you know, it's just like, I just said, truth is true. That's all you need to know. Just truth is true. That's it. Don't need to read any books. So we can boil it down. It's actually easily boiled down to very simple, clear context. And from that standpoint, then people can just, you know, the emphasis is on practice, right? Spiritual practice. The idea that we need to live in some culture with all these books is nonsense. What we need to know is so basic that it's easily transmissible just by speaking or from inner intuition. We want it to be greater than God. We're trying to impress God, that we're impress upon God that we are greater by mixing half-truths. We projected onto God the attack that we were trying to carry out on reality, and we think God's trying to attack us, and we're trying to hide from God so we don't get annihilated. You know, these are basic things, but basically you can boil it down even further and say, look, we have a continuity problem. If we just make that the starting point, the entire situation simplifies. All the difficulty just drops away, is what I've seen. Which is why Judeo-Christian tradition stresses the act of contrition. Say, I am a sinner. I am a sinner. I have a continuity problem. Honesty with God. Just say, God, I can't remember reality. I don't have a clue. That simplifies the whole thing. Totally. Totally, totally simplifies it. We give up trying to impress God, that drops away. We give up trying to impress others, that drops away. What good is it trying to impress others? They have a severe continuity problem too. And then we begin to drop our failure into the one place where success is. which is the vision of oneness. We just say, okay, this is the solution to the continuity problem. I can see it, obviously. I need to be reminded of what reality is like. There's no other way, no other way. If we've forgotten something to such an extent that we're terrified to go back home, as it were, then what do? Of course, we get some gentle reminders first. It's a no-brainer, so it's easy. The entire situation is totally simple, totally basic, totally easy, totally pragmatic. There's no mysteries or surprises or anything like that. It's only our desire to confuse things and to impress God. And again, the fear of the Kanye issue that causes us to throw all this confusion, you know, up in the air. None of it's necessary. It doesn't mean anything. Just say, I don't have a confusion problem. I have a continuity problem. So, what I've been trying to do is find a way. What saves time for everybody? What approach can save the most time or a lot of time? You know, how can we streamline it, modernize it, streamline it, save time? What is the way? And I've seen that to say, I have a continuity problem, this confession of continuity problem, it is the way that I see. It is fabulously helpful. Now, the ego will never understand what the continuity problem is. It will always be unable to comprehend what we're talking about. Because the ego says we don't have a continuity problem because we're staying here forever. We're going to stay in dreaming forever. That's all that it knows. The ego doesn't know reality. Therefore, it thinks this continuity problem is just something we've made up. It's a sign of mental illness, is what the ego thinks. So it can never understand the continuity problem at all. So again, everyone understands the continuity problem. It's easy to understand. It's just, again, the fear of an abrupt change of experiencing. A very abrupt, severe change in our experiencing. Lack of continuity of experiencing. It's very simple. It's the same reason, like on a really hot summer day up at the mountains, you come across this icy, snow-fed mountain river, and you say, "Gosh, I'd love to get in that water, you know, and cool off." But I'm afraid we hesitate because we know the water's icy cold, and here we are, all warm and overheated and stuff, and we don't particularly want to jump in the icy cold water. Abrupt change of experiencing, but dropping the belief in non-eternal life to directly know eternal life is, you know, just an incredible different experience. And to have it happen abruptly, we're just not going to do it. It's just something that our, you know, we're too frightened of it. Way too frightened of it. So, those who are still trying to impress God, follow the vice of the ego, they don't even recognize we have a continuity problem, because the ego doesn't have a clue what that is. It has no idea. It ego doesn't even know anything about reality. All it knows about is dreams and the belief in non-eternal life. That's because it's a projection. It's something we projected. Projected ignorance, as it were. The ego doesn't know. So it cannot relate to the continuity problem at all. Therefore, those who turn to the ego for advice are unaware that we have a continuity problem. They're unaware of it. I discovered this in probably 1977. As I lay down on the floor and I tried to do what Ramana Maharshi did. And as I started to let go of everything, suddenly this huge rush of dread a rose. I said, what in the world is that? What in the world is that? I was just completely taken by surprise. And it was so surprising and amazing. Then I immediately said, I have to find out what's going on here. What is it? And it was the continuity problem. I said, the ego never told me about that. Of course not. It never will. It never will. And yet, the ego knows we have this issue. It doesn't understand it. But it knows that for some reason we want to work on this problem. So it provides us with the answers. Being our advisor, it always has advice for us. Even if it doesn't know what it's talking about, which it never does, it says, I got some advice for you. Don't worry about it. Look, just focus on making your life happy, you know. Be kind, loving one another, be happy, make this a good place, a nice place. You'll forget all about this strange desire to let go of non-eternal life and permanence. And you'll forget all about it. It won't be a problem for you. Don't worry. That's the ego's advice. And so you say, oh, okay. But for me, I said, no. I want to let go of this. So I got to figure out how to lessen the fear here. Come on. And the ego couldn't give me good answers. So I said, I'm going to try it again. I'm going to keep trying. And eventually, you know, I kept trying to let go of impermanence. And I almost did it. But then I realized that I saw directly that I would have to make this huge leap, as it were. And it was possible. I saw it was possible. But I realized it would just be such a continuity gap in terms of the world and functioning in the world and everything. I said, I can't do it. And I saw that it's such a discontinuity issue that virtually nobody's ever going to do that. I could see it's possible that maybe once in a ultra rare, you know, blue moon-ish type of situation. I mean, it's possible that someone might do it. It is possible. But out of, you know, a trillion people, you might have none that do it. None. Or you might have one. But the end result is the same as if somebody takes it the path, the gradual path, as opposed to just leaping direct in. Same outcome. It's not that they become some ultra superhero or something. No. Same outcome. It's just they drop non-eternal life and realize that eternal life has always been the case. So it's the same realization. So it's futile to ignore the continuity problem. But the ego does, except that it humors you and tries to, it knows it has to address something in your mind, but it thinks that you're insane. And so it really, if you look at the world, it's actually like an institution the ego has built now, much of it, to try and heal us from these, what the ego thinks is our vestigial insanity, that we have some things that are holding us back from happiness. And so the ego's literally running this massive healing campaign in the world. What it sees as healing. It really is. There's this massive attempt to heal the world according to the ego's values. Of course, this is actually going to make everything much, much worse. Because we're going to demonize the very path that we need to emphasize. What happened in my case was once I saw how difficult it actually is, no matter how hard I try, I'm not going to succeed in leaping directly back into eternal, dropping non-eternal life and being directly aware of eternal life. I'm not going to do it. Then I got really desperate and I said, wow, I need help. And that very moment then, I said, I really have to have help. And whatever has been helping me up to this point is a liar. It's not helping me. And that is when I began to get the help from what people call the Holy Spirit. I didn't call it that. I just didn't have any word for it at all. I just began to recognize that there was some intelligence, super intelligence, helping me, that somehow was aware of everything. And gradually I became to realize that we have this continuity problem. And most of the people in the world don't even realize this. They think they have some kind of deep-seated madness or insanity or something. It's not insanity that the problem is, the continuity problem. So you can say, I don't have an insanity problem, I have a continuity problem. And this is true. The ego tells you that you have this insanity problem, that you think you can drop impermanence and drop it for eternal life. And the ego says, no, that's some kind of insanity you have, and I mean, you need to be cured from that. So most people think that they need to be cured by the ego of this situation. They don't see it as a continuity problem. They see it as delusion. It's not a delusion, it's a continuity problem. So what I'm seeing is the way is to transfer all this stuff. I don't have a delusion problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have an insanity problem, I have a continuity problem. That literally takes away the ability of the ego to hook you into its healing plan. Because you don't have those problems anymore. You don't have an insanity problem. And you realize, I don't have an insanity problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have some inferiority complex, I have a continuity problem. I don't have some mythical problem, I have a continuity problem. Again, I don't have a lack of confidence, I have a continuity problem. This just lands a knockout blow on the ego. Just a knockout blow. Because you're denying the way that the ego defines you, okay? You're saying, no, that is misdefinition. You're denying the way the ego perceives you. That's misperception. You don't have all these problems the ego tells you have. You don't have those problems, actually. You have a continuity problem is all it is. That's it. There isn't any other problem you really have at all. It's just that as long as you don't recognize you have a continuity problem, the ego then it can tell you you have all these other issues, and it makes just endless issues arise. It's just horrible. And when you deny you have a continuity problem, you end up just developing all these complexes, just a vast constellation of complex problems. That's the cat. The cat has joined us. That's what happens. And so you reverse that whole process. And you begin to name these problems that the ego has told you that you have. And you deny it. You say, no, I don't have that problem. And you're speaking factually. You don't have that problem. We are not insane. We have a continuity problem. We don't have an insanity problem. We have a continuity problem. Because whim is not really a problem, is it? You just drop it. Gone. Projection, all that stuff is not really a problem at all. But the continuity issue is a problem. That really is a problem. So admit that we actually do have a problem. It's the continuity problem. But we don't have any other problem at all. So we don't need the ego's help on any of that stuff at all. And then we can focus entirely on a continuity problem, and then it's easy to find out who has the answer for that. Yes, the Holy Spirit has the answer for that, the vision of oneness. And we can start to really see what the vision of oneness is, and the ego crumbles because it doesn't really understand it at all. It can, sure, it uses the verbiage and we're all one and blah, 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 we're all connected, all that kind of stuff. It can go through the motions, but it doesn't, you can tell it doesn't really understand it. It doesn't have conviction. It really doesn't have conviction. So then we really listen to the Holy Spirit. We really get it, and we do right spiritual practice. And then we eventually have the vision of oneness and the continuity problem is solved, and that's it. That's it. We're done. We are done. Just like that, we're done. We're finished. Continuity problem is being resolved. We're just abiding in this experiencing the resolution of it and enjoying it. Just like watching the dawn. And then watching the fullness of the day, just enjoying it, like, wow, how cool is it to see the sunrise after all this darkness, you know? After so long of darkness, we're watching the sunrise and we're saying, oh my gosh, yeah, the sun has always been there. But what we're really watching is the darkness gradually dissipate. And we think the sun is rising, et cetera, but actually it's the darkness that's dissipating. The sun has always been there. And gradually we realize that, oh, the sun was never hidden. It's just the clouds of denial were there. The sun was always there. But what the Holy Spirit does is it makes it seem like the sun is rising. The way the clouds dissipate, it seems like, oh, the sun is rising. Okay. It gives a sense of continuity of what we expect, and then eventually it'll dawn upon us that it's always been here. It's just the clouds. Eventually. So the way I look at it is that coming to say, yeah, I do have a real problem, ego, I have a continuity problem, thank you very much, but that's the only problem I have. And denying all of the problems, boy, you want to save immeasurable amount of time and suffering and misery, that's the way. You tell the ego, I don't have a depression problem. Tell yourself, forget about the ego, tell yourself, I don't have a depression problem. I have a continuity problem, that's the only problem I have. I don't have a pain problem. I have a continuity problem. That's the only problem I have. I don't have an insecurity problem. I have a continuity problem. That's the only problem I have. I don't have a survival problem. I have a continuity problem. That's the only problem I have. I don't have any survival problem. I don't have a survival problem. See, the ego has told us we have a survival problem. We have a depression problem. All these things. And they seem to arise. All these problems seem to arise. Where are they getting the energy, or where is this problem coming from? It comes from our fear of the continuity problem. That, and the refusal to accept we have a continuity problem. Then that fear gets projected onto these other so-called conditions. That the ego says, we can cure those things, let's give some medication for that, and that, you know, we can deal with, let's deal with those things. The ego tells you, this is what your problem is, and so you accept it. So you can say, I don't have an anxiety problem. I do not have an anxiety problem. I have a continuity problem. You take back the definitions from the ego. The ego's been defining you. You take back your own definition, and accept the definition the Holy Spirit has of you. Simply, you are spirit, the creation of God, your eternal life, and you have a continuity problem. That's it. That's the only definition there is of you. You have a continuity problem. I have a continuity problem. That's it. No other definition is needed. Now, this takes practice for sure. But not that much. Now, from the glimpses that I've had of this dawning, it's so mellow. There's nothing to be afraid of at all. It is so beautiful and mellow, and just like, wow, where has this been my whole life? So don't be afraid of saying, I have a continuity problem. It's the only problem I have. Take away from the ego the authority to define what your problem is. Don't give it any more authority. Take away its authority. And when you define only as a continuity problem, where's the ego's authority? Crumbles. Because then it's got to put up or shut up directly. It just, that's the only problem there is. Where's the answer? What's the answer? Vision of oneness. This vision of oneness reminds us of reality. It's the only way to be reminded of reality. And the Holy Spirit can very clearly work with you and suggest right spiritual practice. And the more you practice this, the more the ego crumbles away. A lot of times the ego just is silent. It can't even say anything. It's just stunned. You know, it's just no thoughts come to mind. So it's curtains for the ego when you do this. It's really landing the knockout blow. The ego can be tricky, of course, but we're not interested in how tricky the ego is. So you can say, I don't have a tricky ego problem. I have a continuity problem. Continuity problem is the only problem I have. Vision of oneness is the only value I have. There's no value in tricky ego problems. Tricky ego problems have no value for me. Because trying to solve those problems, what good does that do? That's not the vision of oneness. The ego doesn't value the vision of oneness at all. It can never lead you to what it doesn't value. So it's useless to struggle with the egoic definitions of problems, because it will never lead you to the vision of oneness. The ego doesn't value that. It has zero value on that. It will never lead you there. So we're just wasting time. As you're struggling with all these problems defined by the ego, you're just wasting your time. So you say, I don't have a wasting time problem. I have a continuity problem. This wasting time problem has no value for me. Has no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. Now the ego will say, well, sing a song, make yourself happy. No, I don't have a singing song problem. I have a continuity problem. Singing song problem has no value in reality. Reality is one. Only the vision of oneness reminds us of reality. Reality is one eternal life. That's it. So we have to remind of that. Singing a happy song doesn't do it at all. That's the ego. So working on that happy song has no value for me. No value whatsoever. None. Has no value. Zero value. So impress this upon yourself. Zero value. Zero. None. Not a speck of value. Not even the tiniest value for me. No value. You can say, I don't have a pot problem. I have a continuity problem. The pot problem has no value. No value for me. None. Has zero value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value. You can say, I don't have a parent problem. I don't have a parent problem. The parent problem has no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value. In other words, working on parent problems has no value to you whatsoever. How does that give you the vision of oneness? It doesn't. Just a swamp. Forget it. You don't have a parent problem. You have a continuity problem. Continuity problem is the only problem there is, the only problem that anyone has. But everybody has it. So you realize they have a continuity problem, you have a continuity problem. You insist that's the only problem you have. And then focus on the vision of oneness. Let them do what they're going to do. You do. You save yourself time. I have a friend problem? No. Say, I don't have a friend problem. I don't have a friend problem. I have a continuity problem. The friend problem has no value to me. The friend problem has no value to me as a problem, right? Because it's not a problem. It has no value. It has no value, so it's not a problem. No value. Only the vision of oneness has value. You may get immediate results, you may not. The results may come and go, etc. But I can tell you for sure, these exercises just knock out the ego, just knock it out. And it's the fast track. It is the fast track. This is a very fast track. Without being scary. Without being scary. I don't have a living problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a living problem, I have a continuity problem. The living problem has no value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. And so this way you become very focused on the vision of oneness and how to experience that. And you get very much ready for it. Because you say, well, it's the only value there is. So of course I'm attuning myself to that. What has value. So working with value and problems like this way is the fast track. Bypasses all the other stuff, which is really upside down. Working with value is the you're working with things the right way, because we perceive what we value. What we value is what we're attracted to, and what we believe is important, and what we need to focus on, etc. What we see and everything—it all has to do with what we value. So when we don't value the problems of the world will drop away, and we are left with just the continuity problem. We've accepted just that problem. It's like deflating a balloon or something, just gone. We think that what we perceive is set, but it has to do with our valuing. So our experience, at least in this dream, is guided by valuing. So when we change our valuing, our experience in the dream will change, actually. So I don't have a living problem. I don't have a living problem. I have a continuity problem. The living problem has no value. Vision of oneness has total value. I don't have a weather problem. We're talking about weather. The drought in California is potentially catastrophic, actually. We're supposed to get a little sprinkles tonight. Nothing to help the drought. Another 10 days of dry pattern, that takes us virtually into March. And March is the last legitimate chance for rain here, really. You know, occasionally we get some in April and May, but March is really, can be a wet month. If we go through March with no rain, then you'd have to say the drought is catastrophic here. So weather problems, right? So, but we can say, I don't have a drought problem. I don't have a drought problem. I have a continuity problem. Because the weather is all, this whole world is all part of the ego and our projections. It's all part of our dream. And the only way to get free of that is to awake from the dream. And the only way to awake from the dream is to first see the vision of oneness, is be reminded of reality, so that solves the continuity problem. It's the only way. So it's like if we're having a nightmare, and it's just this terrible nightmare with so many problems. Like, ah, oh, I'm living in this world, it's got all these storms, and it's also got all these drought problems, and I'm this body, and I need food and shelter and all this stuff, and you have this terrible nightmare of struggling against epidemics and plagues and lack of money and people attacking you and crime, you know, just everything. It's this whole terrible nightmare. And then you say, how do I solve that? And you're struggling terribly with like solving these problems. How do we get rain to fall here? How do we conserve water? And gotta let all our plants die and we can't grow food anymore. And you know, da, 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 da. This huge, huge, huge nightmare. Your mind is just boiling with fear and concern. What do you do? What's the obvious answer? You wake up from the dream. That's it. You wake up from the dream. But we won't do that because of the continuity problem. So what we do first is we have this dream of oneness, a vision of oneness. Which reminds us of reality. Which reminds us of the non-dreaming state. And from there, then we easily drop the dream. What happened to all the dream problems? None of them are there, are they? Well, you didn't solve a single one, did you? You solved all of them by waking up. There's not a single problem in a dream you can't solve by waking up. Not one. You could have the most diabolical problem in a dream. Are millions of diabolical problems, and every single one of them we solve completely when you wake up. So why waste time working on all these problems when you can solve them all permanently, perfectly and permanently, simply by waking up? Simply by waking up. So you can say, I don't have a dream problem. I have a continuity problem. Really, that's the truth. I don't have a dream problem. I have a continuity problem. Because the issue is really not the dream, it's awakening from the dream, right? See, I don't have a dream problem, I have a continuity problem. The dream problems have no value. Only the vision of oneness has value. Dream problems don't have any value. Only the vision of oneness has value. Because, again, waking up from the dream is not really a dream problem. It's a waking up problem. See that there's a difference there. When you're trying to wake up from a nightmare and you're having trouble waking up, it's not really, you know, the nightmare that's the problem. It's waking up. Is that's the problem? You're struggling with waking up. It's a waking up problem we have, and we don't. The problem is the continuity fear. Fear of the continuity issue is what makes it difficult to wake up. It's not really the nightmares that make it difficult to wake up. It's not really that stuff. You could say it's the totality of all that, and the familiarity and all, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But it is the totality of it, and therefore it's not any particular problem really at all. And so deny all, each particular problem, just say, no, it's the continuity problem is my only problem. The waking up problem is my only problem. Don't focus on all these individual problems that we have in the dream. I don't have a survival problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a mortality problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a death problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a fatality problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a vulnerability problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have dream problems, I have a continuity problem. Dream problems have no value. Dream problems have no value. Only the vision of oneness has value. So easy to say, right? Say, dream problems have no value. Only the vision of oneness has value. And you say, I wonder why that ego never told me to say that. You could listen to the ego forever. It will never tell you to say that. Never. And so when you say it, you say, what? Wow, that's obvious. I don't have, dream problems have no value. Only the vision of oneness has value. Yeah. How come the ego never told me that? And that's the wow, like, wow. Incredible, huh? And then you feel like, oh, the ego is not to be trusted. Wow, never told me that. The ego will give you millions and millions of practices. It'll never tell you this, that I don't have a dream problem. I have a continuity problem. Dream problem has no value. Dream problems have no value, zero value. Only the vision of oneness has value. It's difficult to get into this practice because the ego won't even give you a hint of how to do it. Not even a hint. So if you turn to the ego and say, ego, can you help me out a little bit? It's going to lead you off and you'll never get started. Never get started. It'll lead you on a wild goose chase. You'll say, well, first do this, and then do this, and then do this, and then do this, and you never get around to it. And before you know it, you're watching some, you know, something else on YouTube, or listening to some music, or your mind is, you know, gone, 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 gone. And you never get around to it. So what I'm saying is you start with saying, I have a continuity problem. My problem is the continuity problem. That's the only problem I have. I have a continuity problem. I can't remember what reality is like. I'm afraid to wake up. I have a continuity problem. You just start there. And you keep saying that, and then you start identifying whatever pops in your mind, catch it, and say, I don't have that problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have an uncertainty problem. I have a continuity problem. You know, as you feel this uncertainty, I don't have an uncertainty problem. My real problem is the continuity problem. I have a continuity problem. That's the only problem I have. And then you keep working on this. Gradually that builds up momentum until then you can begin to. It'll be easy to say other statements that the ego will never tell you about. Like, I don't have, dream problems have no value. You know, that's a very strong statement. Dream problems have no value. Only the continuity problem, only the vision of oneness has value. And then eventually you'll get tired and you'll turn to the ego and say, how'd it go, ego? You know, the ego will say, oh, you know what, let's find out. Let's see, and let's go listen to this song and see how you feel. And man, are you happy, you know? And then, you know, you get off track again. Easily you get off track, but that's normal. You're going to check in with the ego just to make sure it's still there, at least a little bit. And it's still there. It's still there. It's just kind of shocked. Well, all right. So, again, these videos are just helping out. It's so simple. Just, I have a continuity problem. It's the only problem I have. Start out that way, and you can build up. Your practice will just build up and build up and build up. Don't check in with the ego. It's not about checking in with the ego when you're practicing. Wait until later. But the ego tries to tell you, okay, assess how you're doing. Assess how you're doing. Don't assess how you're doing. Refuse to assess. I don't have an assessment problem. I have a continuity problem. The assessment problem has no value. It's right, the assessment problem has no value. Only the vision of oneness has value. Is assessment the vision of oneness? No. So, if it's not the vision of oneness, it has no value. There's no reason to assess how you're doing. Turn to the ego, how am I doing, ego? You know, of course the ego's gonna engage you then at that point. And then your practice will come to a screeching halt. Just keep taking away everything from the ego. Just keep on doing it. Don't worry how you're doing, just do it. As long as you're doing it, you're being very effective. No question about it. No question about it. You can say, I don't have an ego problem. I have a continuity problem. The ego problem has no value. The ego problem has no value. Only the vision of oneness has value. So the basic practice, this basic practice is what builds up momentum so that there are times when you're able to then begin to add on even more profound statements that bring you into this dawning of the vision of oneness begins to dawn. But keep on doing the basic practice. Makes you more and more and more and more stable. And then the more stable you are, the better the dawning can be. The more the dawning can come. Don't worry if the dawning doesn't come in any particular time of practice. Just keep practicing. practice problem. I have a continuity. The vision of oneness has value. I don't have an enlightenment problem. I have a continuity problem. The enlightenment problem has no value. Only the vision of oneness has value. Again, bring everything back to just that vision of oneness. I don't care what it is. All you need is that vision of oneness. That is it. There's nothing else we need. Nothing. Nothing else we need whatsoever. That's the reminder that works. Don't need to add anything. Don't need to subtract anything from it. No addition, no subtraction. As it is. As it is, as it is. Then you can go into the as it is practice. This plant, as it is self-released eternal life. This pebble, as it is self-released eternal life, is optimal. This pebble, as it is optimal. This plant as it is optimal. This plant as it is vastness. This plant as it is the vast one. Is the one. This is the one. This table is the one. This plant is the one. This moment 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 as it is the one. The one is the one. This moment as it is the one. This moment as it is the one. This moment as it is the one without another, without a second. Without any addition or any subtraction, without a second. This moment as it is the one, is the center of oneness. This plant as it is the center of oneness. It is the vast center of oneness. It is the optimal vast center of oneness. It is the totality of happiness. It is the one happiness. It is the eternal life. This plant as it is the oneness. This is the oneness. This is this. This is the oneness. The oneness is the oneness. So, then these practices are easy then to get into. And these practices bring us close to the dawning of God realization, the vision of oneness. It brings us very, very close to it. And then at some moment it may begin to dawn upon us as we're doing the practices. Or maybe not. Sometimes it does, sometimes it doesn't. Don't look for it, because it then you won't see it. Just keep practicing. This is. This spaciousness is the spaciousness. This is. And what I'm finding is that the words become less and less and less until you almost feel like you don't even, you know, words aren't even necessary. All of this is very doable, isn't it? Piece of cake. Piece of cake. And the ego, of course, they'll say, "Wow, what are you doing? You're gonna go crazy. You're going into complete psychosis." You know, and if you ask the ego's opinion, don't ask the ego's opinion. The ego has no value. The ego problem has no value.